Hello, everybody. Good afternoon. Welcome to Webinar Wednesday. My name is Martin Lofvers. I'm Chief Talent Watcher of Supply Chain Media. You might also know me as the Editor-in-Chief of Supply Chain Movement. And I'm also the architect of the SCM IT Supermap we're going to discuss this afternoon. We have an interesting discussion going on right now. And, you know, I'll have an expert on choosing the right software, supply chain software with me. You see me on the left, and with me I have Hans van der Drift, partner at Involvation. Hans, welcome.
Good afternoon, thanks, welcome.
So, some practical information. So, everybody's on mute, all the participants, but feel free to ask questions during the webinar this coming hour. You have two options. You can either use the chat functionality, or you could use the Q&A at the right-hand side. So please use the Q&A to ask questions. If the questions are in line of our conversation, well, I will pick it up and I ask these questions right away. If not, we will have a Q&A at the end, you know, five minutes before the end of the hour. And afterwards, between 5 o'clock and 5:30 CET, we also have 30 minutes after talk, so you can go directly to the lounge and speak to Hans or me about the things we have discussed. So if you have more questions, you have different options. So feel free to ask the questions in the Q&A. You can enlarge your screen. You see the slides in front of you. You have the small arrows on the upper right side, so you can enlarge your screens. So we will have the cameras off. We're live, but you know, it's not necessary to see us. So if you can, if you want to see the slides bigger shape, you know, you can enlarge it by that. All right. So, okay, you know, a lot of companies are looking for supply chain software, and I show you here the Gartner hype cycle of last year. The only purpose why I'm showing it, you know, there are a lot of what we, Laura Siri, ex Gartner, is saying, you know, shiny objects. So there are a lot of new technology developments. On the left hand side, you see some innovative starting stuff, digital supply chain twins on the left hand side. And then you go on top of the hype, you have, you know, the peak of inflated expectations. And then you go into the trough of disillusionment. And what you see here, machine learning is heading into a trough. So a lot of companies are talking about machine learning, but a lot of companies have to expect a lot of disappointments. And then you get the slope of enlightenment. And in the end, to the right, you get the plateau of productivity. And then all these kind of systems, you know, are you're very effective and, you know, are gaining productivity. Hans, what do you think if you are looking at this hype cycle?
Yeah, interesting question. There's obviously quite a lot on this chart. I think one of the areas that I was quite interested in is the digital supply chain strategy that is sort of on the way up, mm-hmm. Where I think lots of people would define them in different ways. Basically, what we try and do is basically do two things. One is have the supply chain strategy in its broader sense, where we talk about the drones in the and the robotics, etc. And then I think the area that we're focusing on a bit now is a subset of that, which I would call digital planning, where there is a lot going on, and that we're going to go back on in the part of the session later.
Yeah, and another thing is supply chain segmentation in the slope of enlightenment. Still, I think a lot of companies should segment their portfolio way better and also let it be supported by IT systems. So a segmentation simultaneously on product and customer level is hardly seen within companies. So you hardly see any matrix every month generated with the ERP systems about, you know, what is the profitability on a product and a customer level at the same time. So that's something I think there should be something to develop. What do you see in that area, Hans?
What is meant by segmentation? Obviously, segmentation. I mean, lots of companies apply segmentation in some shape or form. Mm-hmm. The true value of course sits in. So what do you do with it? It's always nice to have all these analyses, etc. But then, are you really able to then draw conclusions based on that analysis and really do something different in a different segment? Because otherwise, you might as well forget about it.
Yep. Right. Okay. So what we did last year, just after the first wave of the pandemic, we did a survey among 106 manufacturing companies and a few retail companies in Europe. And here you see the response and results. So sales and operations planning is still the number one overall. So you see an orange bar and a blue bar. So the orange bar are, you know, the more mature companies, according to the Gartner level 4 and 5. 5 is the maximum, orchestrating supply chain. The blue ones is overall. And as you can see, you know, the more mature companies already have S&OP in place to some extent, but still a lot of them are still implementing it. And highlighted with red, you know, you see the investments by the more mature companies. So end-to-end supply chain visibility is peaking overall, but also among the more mature companies. Supply chain network design is also, you know, back again on the race, part of the pandemic, supply problems, that kind of stuff. Real-time transport visibility, we'll get back to that in the IT supply map later on, is on the rise, especially in the more mature companies. And also supply chain risk management as a software type is on the rise among the more mature companies. I know, Hans, you have been working at Unilever in the past, and you also have implemented SAP APO, so you are in deep in the S&OP environment. What do you think if you are looking at this environment and this slide?
Yeah, I think it's interesting that after all these years, it's still the biggest focus area in terms of investments. Mm-hmm. Not surprisingly, because I mean, we've been talking about S&OP for many years, but in fact, only in the past decade, I think it's really taken off. And at the same time, maybe probably on the back of that, you can see there's been huge developments in what these modern tools can do. So I think a lot of the investments that we are seeing here are not first investments, but they're basically replacements. Yep. Or upgrades. Yep. So I think there's one view. The second view that I think you mentioned already, that the leading companies, they're actually one step ahead and moving now to more end-to-end supply chain visibility rather than next to, let's say, their S&OP software, because they've done that part, the big step already.
Yeah. We also, you know, it's not in this slide, make the segmentation on the lesser mature companies, and the lesser mature companies are mainly focusing on ERP, enterprise resource planning, and warehouse management systems to implement. So basically to get their basis in order, especially after the first wave of the corona pandemic last year, you know, they came to the conclusion that either the ERP or the WMS was not up to speed for their purpose of the supply chain. Getting back to Gartner, you know, I think almost 10 years ago, they introduced the PACE layered application strategy. And it's our illustration on the left side, a visualization of what they have been trying to explain in a lot of words. But basically, what they have been saying, and I totally agree with them, that you have different kind of applications, different kind of levels or layers. So to explain this visualization, on the lower end, you have your system of records, where you have your orders, your sales orders especially, and you have probably different kind of ERP systems and even legacy systems, IBM systems of the 80s or whatever. And in the middle layer, you have your system of differentiations. That's the area where you have your planning, your warehouse management, your transport management, your forecasting and scheduling, your APS. And on top of them, you have your system of innovation. You could say, you know, I have to update this visual, you know, machine learning, cognitive kind of tools, that's the area, apps you can plug into. So that's basically how they have visualized and formalized the different kind of layers in your application world. How do you look at this slide? What do you see in your practice looking around, Hans?
Yeah, I think basically linked to the previous slide where people, where companies are investing, it's first things first. So I think that it's a bit of an open door, but at the same time, it's also can be quite helpful to help companies basically build their roadmaps dependent on where they sit today. Because if you don't have your systems of record in order, well, let's go there first before we start at the top. So it's, I think it's, most of it is quite obvious that it's not, there's no rocket science here, but I think it's still quite useful to make the differentiation.
Yeah, and also what Gardner stated is you don't have to have one environment. So say, put it all in one SAP environment, you know. So in the current world, it's more like a best of breed approach by most of the companies rather than all in an SAP world or an Oracle environment with all the systems. That's also basically what this slide is saying. If you move on, so you have different kind of layers, and this is a helpful slide. You know, we also saw that in our survey with the maturity going from left to right. You know, first you get in the area of you have hardly any data, you're just guessing. Then you go in the area of small data. If there is big data, there is obviously also small data. So what is small data? Small data in this definition is internal structured data. And structured data, I mean from ERP, CRM, WMS, TMS, those kind of systems. That's structured data. That's small data. And you know, you can do reporting with it. And then going a level higher, getting more mature, you hopefully you are getting better in reporting. And then in forecasting what will happen next. So and then you can also use internal unstructured data. What are those? Emails and other data like that internally. And moving on, you get into the external structured data. And then, you know, forecasting using the weather or other stuff. It's also in predictive analytics. And moving on the highest level, you get prescriptive analytics. You know, it's what you want to happen. And then you're moving on. Basically, what I'm saying. You have to, start walking before you run. So don't jump to the highest level if you are not into the basic reporting. You know, if you have your data in order, so master data management is quite important. And also get rid of your Excels to one extent. So otherwise, you get stuck and you can't move on. So this is also something what you are using for your advice to companies if they want to move on.
Yeah, I think, and also, I mean, looking forward to the rest of the slide deck. This is something that's going to be coming back, I think, when we talk about the new kids on the block.
Yeah.
Where there's a few things here. I think at the bottom, that's the interesting part in terms of what sort of data, what types of data are you able to use and to exploit?
Mm-hmm.
Where we now, actually, in my view, for the first time, are seeing the use from structured to unstructured data.
Yep.
Basically, because the tools can handle it, but also only recently, I think, can we really exploit and extract value from that.
Yeah.
Where I mean, you made a reference to my APO history, which is a long time ago.
Yep.
But still, I think quite an advanced tool in those days with optimizers, etc. But everybody really got. Completely crazy about all the data and every lever that you needed to settle well and to configure well, and otherwise the thing wouldn't work properly. That's of course never going to completely disappear, but I think the modern tools and also the availability of data now enables that completely structured way of working. We can probably as a starting point still going to be there, but we can then start enriching it with more external data, end-to-end data, because the tools are able to handle it and because the data is there.
Yeah. Talking about end-to-end, so we also ask the companies, are they going to invest in end-to-end supply chain visibility? The answer is yes. For a lot of companies, I think almost 40%. But looking at the end-to-end supply chain visibility, I have dissected it. You know, what is it? You know, is it upstream to the left, you know, with the orange brown area with your suppliers, tier one, tier two, and beyond? Is it your internal visibility? Do you know what's happening with all your orders? What's the status of it? And you have different layers, again, ERP, APS, WMS, and so forth. One. Inventory order management, so higher up, it's getting more strategic, S&OP, and then you have other systems, also your SRM and CRM and IBP. I have defined as a different kind of environment than an S&OP environment. S&OP still in volumes and IBP also into scenarios and financially matching and explaining with your budget, and then network design, and on top of that you get in the cognitive machine learning area. So that's my internal visibility, and then downstream you have also your forecasting in your commercial channels. So I think this the whole plethora of applications and end-to-end supply chain visibility can either be on a more operational level, where are my goods, on a more technical level, capacities internally, externally, and strategic, even in your financial viability of your strategic suppliers and customers. So there are also different layers to explain that end-to-end supply chain visibility, yes, is needed, but it is quite complex and quite widespread. Do you see a lot of companies wanting end-to-end supply chain visibility, not knowing what it entails?
Well, I think when you ask people what end-to-end visibility means, they'll always say, yes, I know what it means. But I think that at the moment, actually, there's quite a few nice examples where, partly because of the COVID crisis, we now start to understand the real impact if there is no end-to-end visibility. And we're all seeing upstream, for example, you quote the supply chain risk and compliance. Mm-hmm. We at the moment actually getting quite a number of assignments and doing a lot of work on supply chain resilience, where and people now realize that if they don't have that view, they're extremely vulnerable when something happens somewhere in the world.
Yeah.
Where, I mean, we all read the articles about automotive, we all the articles about bicycles, about, but also carton, about where either on the upstream side, the risks were not so clear, and downstream also, where demand fluctuations, very obvious during a crisis, obviously, but normally also happening. If you don't know, well, you're never going to really understand what's going on, and you're going to be reactive. So I think, and we saw that in the investment part also, that the leading companies are investing in end-to-end visibility.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly, I think, because of these reasons. Downstream to exploit and understand what's going on in the market and what they can expect in terms of volumes. And upstream to make sure that they are able to deliver and understand their risks in case of disruptions.
Yeah, we get to that to the IT supply map, where you have a special supply line called supply chain risk management, where you have players like Risk Methods, Prewave, and Resilience 360. Basically, they are going through all kinds of social media and other open sources, and they find out what are the risks happening, and they can have an early warning system for the users of it. So AGCO, manufacturer of tractors, is using Risk Methods, and with this kind of software, they were able to predict the impact of COVID-19 already in December 2019, so a month ahead compared to the automotive. And usually they are ordering the same kind of parts the automotive is ordering, and AGCO could still remain producing the whole last year, whereas the automotive didn't have the parts and sometimes the capacity to produce. So that's what you see right here. What we are seeing right now, and I had discussions with Unilever and Henkel and others, that the whole thing of control towers, it's changing in a sense. And then we came up, Supply Chain Media came up with the phrase a convergent planning tower, and that's what I've described in the current edition of Supply Chain Movement. Basically, you have a T-shaped planning tower, and on the standing part, you have different layers. The orders are entering your ERP system, your sales orders, and then to the second floor, you have your sales and operation execution systems, it was called the order management, warehouse management, transport management, to make it work, to ship and that kind of stuff. And then the next layer, you have your S&OP floor, where you have your capacity on the midterm, and maybe a longer term, but mostly on the midterm, supply and demand volumes being matched. And then moving up, you have your IBP floor, where you're translating into financial scenarios and the gaps with your budget and closing it. And then on top, you have your end-to-end planning and environment with your scenarios, your digital twins. And basically, on that layer, you are on the market side, you look at what's happening on the market, social trends, shifts in buying behavior on one hand, And on the supply side, you know, you see all kind of ecosystems competing with each other. So like, you know, on chips, Apple is competing with cars, with PlayStation, and even, you know, what I saw a few weeks ago, that automotive is competing with hospitals, in the sense that a car manufacturer couldn't produce. Why? They couldn't get any steel from an Indian supplier because they didn't produce, because they are lacking oxygen, and all the oxygen went to the hospitals. So, you know, based on the availability of hospitals, automotive is competing to hospitals. And even what you see now, earlier today, we got a, you know, I read in the financial newspapers that in Taiwan, there's a shortage of water, and even there might be some shutdowns in ship manufacturing because there is not enough water. So now even lack of water can make happen that, that there will be even more shortage in ICs and chips. So that's the new world we're getting in. So basically, on the top level, you see the whole strategic environment with supplies and ecosystems competing, and you will get there. You know, you'll see different kind of systems, vendors who are addressing that environment. Your comment on this, Hans?
Yeah, I think your drawing quite nicely illustrates the necessity of solid foundations, because mm-hmm. in this building, I'm not an architect, but it still looks sort of slightly unstable. Which means that it can work perfectly, but if you don't have your EOP, your SNOE up to in order, for example, and you're really demand supply balancing SNOP process on top of that, then let's not move to the next layer. So I think for any company, I think this illustrates quite nicely that you really have to start at the bottom, yeah. Understand where you stand today. Your ambition, I'm sure when we ask, lots of companies are going to be willing to have the end-to-end visibility and digitize, et cetera. But at the same time, you need to be realistic because these steps can be quite significant. One, tooling-wise, but also in terms of the people that you need, the organization, the impact on your processes. And it takes time to get from SNOE all the way up to RBP, all the way up to end-to-end, etc. It sounds simple, but it's not.
No. And regarding the architecture of this building, you know, the Dutch are famous for their architectural skills. So you see Rem Koolhaas in Rotterdam has designed a building like this. And even in Tokyo and in China, he was able to create this kind of buildings. So it is possible, but you need some architectural skills, in this case on an IT level. Why it's called convergent? What I see, you know, you have the horizontal part on top of the standing part, and there where it's coming together. So when I look at Kinexys, when they talk about concurrent planning, it's like the standing part, in my opinion, where they can switch from supply chain scenarios into scheduling and backwards. So that's the standing part. But when you look on the top part, you know, there are digital twins connecting with all kinds of systems in a totally different way. But in the end, those standing part and this top floor are connecting somewhere where you have to decide, make strategic decisions for your supply chain, even strategic decision what you can execute next day. So that's the conversion point there where it's coming all together, your end-to-end area. That's what I'm calling it, the convergent planning tower. You know, some people ask me, you know, how does a digital supply chain planning ecosystem look like? And I already showed you a simplified version in the end-to-end supply chain visibility framework. Here you see an overview of an actual ecosystem of a very advanced company, and they have taken 5 years to implement it, to roll it out. Now you can see who it is, but I won't mention it. That's not important. But anyway, you have your data layer on the lowest end, your ERP and other systems with your product management system and machines, that kind of stuff. And on top of that, you have a data layer, collaboration layer, or extraction layer, or data lake, different kind of names for the same kind of environment. They are, you know, this layer is extracting data from all kind of ERP systems and machine layers. And then you get to your planning layer, call it WMS, APS, TMS, and you see all kind of systems here implemented in this environment. And then to connect it all, you have an integrated business planning layer, you know, extracting for all these modules below. And then on top of that, you have another layer where you have your dashboards, your cockpits, and you name it. And on the upper right-hand side, you have your data ocean. And then you're talking about external data, unstructured data, social media, Facebook, Instagram, and you name it, but also industry data. And that's a different kind of environment. That's what they call a data ocean to analyze, also for your marketing and your business analysts. And on the top layer, you have your cognitive layer, and then you talk about machine learning and AI, decision trees, and make more sense of it all. So this is a complex ecosystem, but this is, what this company has designed and been implementing for the last 5 years. And even now, they are very successful in their use of it, but they're not ready even now. And maybe, there are system from other vendors, not for one vendor, you might recognize it, but also others, and they are happy with it. But basically, they design this whole portfolio based on a strategy. So this is not the starting point. No, they have a transformation strategy, and based on their needs, they came up with the necessity to create this kind of environment. Hans, if you are advising companies on supply chain planning as such, you also get this kind of interesting, complex overviews?
Yeah, but it's all very often the starting point. The one is, there's always aspects around functionality, obviously. And then the second one is always going to be, so what about the integration aspects?
Yeah.
I think what the current development is, or the current, but with in the last so many years, from sort of hard-coded interfacing, extremely rigid, so therefore also IT departments often winning the battle of going for one vendor just because of the integration aspects and to making sure that it all hangs together sensibly. And I think what this picture demonstrates, although these guys seem to be going for a single vendor strategy as much as possible, but this, I think this picture shows that by building these data layers in between, once you've defined the standards and you're able to feed that data from your transactional systems, you could then start to plug in the additional applications using all the exact same data, integrating seamlessly, basically, or using the same assumption and the same data sets, without having the users having to worry about consistency in the data.
Yep.
So I think that's both for between transactional and planning parts, but also similarly towards the cognitive layer, where you get basically one data source and then very fancy tools being able to analyze real time with your flash memory.
Yeah.
So I think that's quite a significant development that's been going on for a while now.
Yeah. And to explain this data layer, when you have this data layer on top of your ERP environment, you don't have a need to have APIs between all your modules on top of that onto your ERP, and that is a one thing. I had a conversation earlier this week with one big multinational also looking in this direction, and one of the fears was, if we are choosing for one vendor and we have to roll it out in the next 3 years, what is the risk that this application is outdated when we are 3 years further ahead? So Hans, what is your response to that?
Yeah, I mean, if that's your reasoning, you should probably never. You're still going to buy your first computer. So obviously that is the case, and the bigger and the more complex your organization is, the bigger of an aspect this will be. At the same time, developments are going fast, but it's not like you can't implement fast enough. So I think once you've built your infrastructure, and I think definitely when you build it in a modular way like these guys have been doing, then you can also cherry pick where you want to upgrade.
Yep.
And also leave the parts that are just working fine and where there's no significant development. So Absolutely. I mean, building the platform, the basics, that takes a long time. But yeah. Hopefully you're not going to do that every 3 years.
No.
And then building the specific applications, the functionality on top, and that's where you're going to make the difference. Hopefully it's not going to be so big.
Yeah. All right. Let's take a look at our current or our new SEM IT Supermap Europe 2021. So this is how it looks like at this moment. And people may have seen this before, hopefully, especially when you're interested in supply chain software. Basically, to explain it all, you have different kind of supply lines. You have a black line called ERP, red is warehouse management, and so forth and so on. So you see in the agenda all the different kind of software types, all related to supply chain, I would say. Even procurement, e-procurement is there. So this is the whole environment of supply chain software. And basically, I have created this software map based on the input from vendors. So, and we have a whole methodology behind it. So they only get a subway station based on the number of projects, the share of revenue in Europe as part of the total. There are some thresholds. So if they have done only one or two implementations and they're quite big companies, you know, they are not specialized in that specific function. And so they don't get a subway station on that subway line. So basically this subway line represents the proven ability of these vendors in certain areas. Just like the magic quadrant, those are all opinions and based on very thorough research, same here. But still, as you can see, you know, I'm the supply chain architect of this subway map. So this is my opinion based on all the data I've gathered from the vendors, from themselves, but also from their websites, from what I hear and what I see and what I read. So this is the representation of the supply chain software world in Europe. So you have to have at least two offices in Europe. Or if you are an international American player, you have to have also your own office in Europe next to your American offices. So that's why not all the vendors you can imagine, you know, in America, there are a lot of supply chain software vendors that don't have their own office in Europe. So they are not on this map. So we are, you know, focusing on the European market, and that's, you know, all these vendors are represented right here. And then upper right side, you see also some companies like Accenture and also Evaluation mentioned as companies who are advising companies to select these vendors. And I know that a lot of these consultancies have this poster on their wall. Even Gartner, you know, admitted that a lot of the Gartner analysts have this poster of this IT supermap on the wall to make sure that they don't forget any important vendor. How about you, Hans? Do you know this subway map?
Yeah, it looks familiar, Martijn.
It's good to know.
Yeah, definitely. And we use it quite actively. And that was what I did a quick check with the last few of the releases. And what I noticed is that it's probably not the the London subway, but more Shanghai type, the China type. Because when you look at the London subway map, it was built in the 1800s and is still more or less the same as it's today.
Yeah.
And this one is changing all along with new subway stations and new lines every year.
Yeah.
Which is more sort of the China style. And also from that perspective, I find it quite useful to get your view, supply chain and management IT view, on what's going on in this world.
Yeah. There are new lines coming up. You see the gray one is yard management. That's a new super line we have introduced this year for the first time. And what I've noticed in the last 2 years, you know, yard management used to be a forgotten area, the weakest link between transport management and warehouse management. And so, you know, the trucks entering the compound, maybe, you know, creating a traffic jam and, you know, causing disruptions in the manufacturing or in your distribution. So this is what we have added for this year. So the super line of yard management. Another thing, what we have done since last year, you see the visibility line, end-to-end supply chain visibility. Basically, in, you know, 10 years ago, you had GT Nexus being bought by Infor later on. So those were applications connecting all kind of layers and applications to get visibility. So that's the end-to-end supply, the visibility line, the light green line on the supply map. But last year we introduced a subline on the green line called real-time transport visibility. And you see in Europe, you have basically four kites, Project 44, CPO and Sixfold. Romby is a new entry for this year. Project 44, four kites, coming from America. By the way, Project 44 has bought a Danish company a few years ago. Shipio is coming from France. Sixfold is coming from Austria. And by the way, now you see that Transporia already on the green line. They have bought Sixfold in last fall. So this is what you see that's developing. So here you see real-time transport visibility, a very hot topic, considering our own survey, what we've done last June. So these are probably the ones to look for. Let me see. A question. Hi, is there an overview of the marketplace that support the query for supply chain risk and sustainability? Yes, we do have, and you see the one, Resilience 360 is one, but you have Risk Methods, even Coupa, and Coupa has bought LlamaSoft, also interesting to see. So there are some software vendors in that area, and Prewave is a smaller one. So yeah, there are software, covering supply chain risk management. If you want to see if it's sustainability, maybe, but in the sustainability end, you see new startups like Sustainable coming up and some more. So in the sustainability area, considering supply chain risk, you see new startups coming up and they are not always represented on this map. So maybe if they are getting big enough, becoming a scale up, they will be part of this supply map. Another thing, and that, a part is zooming in on the supply map, you see newcomers, I think Blue Ridge coming over in the US, very successful now in Scandinavia. And a differentiator in that area is that they have included pricing optimization. So that's a new angle to forecasting and demand planning. Another one, Flowlity, a French company, used to be a startup, now a scale-up, very rapidly growing. And basically what they're doing is forecasting as a service. So yes, you can use it for forecasting and demand planning, but they do it in the cloud, but also they are, you can share it with your customers and suppliers. So if even your suppliers are using the same system, they can advise both parties where to put your stock. So cross industry stock optimization is an option when you're looking at a vendor like Flowlity. So that's totally new kind of application. And Jarvis, that's one of the first startups on this map, and it's so new and but so hot in the sense that even the big companies are looking at it. Their claim is with 1 hour of training, you can implement it. Your own demand planning can implement this software within 1 day. So this is the new world we're getting into. So they have all kind of tools to make that happen. Hans, how do you look at this environment of newcomers?
Yeah, I think there's a few remarks to this. I think what's interesting to see here is that here I find your subway map more useful than what Gartner is doing. Example, a nice example is Relic Solutions, focusing hardcore retail, quite advanced, very good functionality. Probably one of the also all the bigger suppliers don't even come close, but they'll never make it into the Gartner quadrants because they're not ticking all the boxes.
No,
and they're probably too small still. But actually, when you're a retailer, I think you should really consider them.
Yeah.
The companies that dare to focus and therefore probably excel in those areas come out a lot better here, I think, than in the Gartner quadrants.
So yeah.
And then, as I said, the second observation is that some of these companies didn't exist or in the subway maps 1-2 years ago.
Yeah.
And now all of a sudden they start popping up because they have something special to offer, yeah. Which I think is quite nice.
And even, you know, some are fading away. So there are also companies who are being left out for this year's subway map. So they didn't make it anymore because, you know, they are fading away. They're becoming obsolete. And, you know, that's kind of a legacy environment. So they are not implementing or selling software anymore, just maintaining it. So it's also happening. Yeah, Blue Ridge, you know, is very successful in the wholesale environment. Relax Solutions coming from Finland is successful in the retail environment. So there are specific niches over there. You mentioned Gartner and you know, highly respected party, I would say, and you know, very useful to look at it. So this is the magic quadrant of Gartner considering supply chain planning. Interesting, you know, a few years ago they introduced the magic quadrant for supply chain system of record, and it was totally confusing. I thought that system of record was your ERP environment, and system of differentiation is your planning, your S&OP environment. So I was already confused when they named it in that sense. I think it has to do something with the SAP environment and that kind of thing. To explain it, 20 years ago, some Gartner people explained to me that this magic quadrant wasn't supposed to be used for software selection. It was to use for the software vendors to, you know, to benchmark each other, you know, so how I'm doing compared to the other. So that's one thing how it was originally designed. But, you know, some companies are using it to see, okay, what kind of vendors are available and what I should look for. Looking at the axis, you have the completeness of vision and the ability to execute. Interesting part, you know, you see Slimstock, very successful also around the world, expanding rapidly. They have decided just to focus on wholesale and retail companies. So it's a choice by them, obvious strategic choice, just to focus on those companies and not going to the whole enchilada, also manufacturing companies. So that's the reason why in that area, and very successfully so. But in the opinion of Gartner, you know, they're lacking completeness of vision. I tend to disagree. And what I saw a few years ago, a large food manufacturing company wanted to select software and just invited by then the six vendors mentioned in the upper right quadrant. And after a year, they came to the conclusion, no, four of them were totally not fitting. And in the end, they not even selected one of these. They also invited some of them outside this system, like Optimity. I think great software, but not even on this map. So, you know, it's not complete. Something to add on your side, Hans?
No, I think that I can just build on that. And you mentioned that it's not meant for software selections. I tend to agree on that because I think it's quite useful. These oversights and see what's going on and get their view. They spend a lot of time so we check what they're saying, like we use in other sources. I think the element that's missing here, if you think about selections and so what should I be considering if I'm company X, is the industry segment element. Because as you say, a nice example like Slimstock, I think it's quite powerful that they dare to choose and make it very specific. And if it fits, I mean, they're a relatively simple solution maybe, but if it fits, I mean, the users are really happy with it. Yeah. But if you're not a wholesaler, yeah, well, then that's probably not your solution.
No.
You go somewhere else. And that aspect somehow gets, the matrix gets a bit distorted because that view is missing.
Yeah, there's a notion also, you know, that the companies are paying to be on the upper right side, or, you know, I tend to disagree with that. You know, yes, that in some time you have to pay to be you know, considered by Gartner and that kind of stuff, but it's not a matter of the more you pay, the better you will be positioned. I totally disagree with that. But on the other hand, you know, the more you're talking with the analysts of Gartner, the better they understand how you're doing and what you're developing, etc., the higher the chance you will be better positions. But that, you know, it's not like in the direct sense that you can pay for your position. I don't think so. What I did 2 years ago, I think, you know, getting into the notion what Hans mentioned, you know, the industry focus as such. In my opinion, there are four angles actually to consider when you are selecting software. So first, you have functionality, upper left side. Then technology, is it cloud-based, is it modern, how is it developed, you know, and what kind of language, that kind of stuff. The delivery part, you know, is this company able to implement globally or in Europe, and how, from different offices, locally or not, or remotely. And the lower right side, what's their knowledge for an industry, a market, an area? So that's my opinion. So what I'm, you know, my goal is to map an individual software vendor, say, for example, Slimstock, and just ask these questions that you see at the axis in quality and quantity, and they get a dot for each matrix. And based on this overview, you get a feeling of this vendor. And maybe this vendor is very knowledgeable in your industry in the wholesale, but maybe on the functionality is not so complex or advanced like others. So basically, this overview would give more deep insight of the vendor on different angles, on functionality, technology, delivery, and knowledge. And I'm also advising companies looking for software, use this kind of overview to plot. Otherwise, it will be just talking about functionality, the more the better, and whatever. And I think that's not the case. Hans, have you something to comment on this plan of mine, this IT vendor map?
Yeah, no, I think, and I'm looking forward to the results, because I'm sure we're going to use it as a source as well. and I think I think we tend to generally over-focus maybe a bit on functionality, and yeah. Not we, but in general. And what I find is that definitely when you do the RFIs and when you read the websites, etc., and you also even get to understand the companies from the inside, 90% of the functionalities overlap. They all can do the demand planning and etc. And the supply, but the differentiation comes really in a number of other aspects nowadays, and that's that part. And we talk about it in the last part of this session. Yeah. That's exactly the part that's evolving now, and that also makes the number of options bigger, which is great, but therefore also a bit more complex, maybe.
Yes, and you know, delivery. You know, how many references, live references, do you have in a certain industry or a certain country? You know, that's on the lower end. So if you are very successful in wholesale and retail, you know, you have to watch it and you have to regard it higher on that sense. So that's one of the delivery part. I think that's how many customers do they have in certain areas, in certain industries, that kind of stuff. I know that the involvation, especially you, are doing a lot of selections, especially on sales and operations planning. So what's your take on that? You know, so how do you select S&OP software?
Yeah, I think we're going to just obviously show a limited number of relatively generic slides. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that I think is happening or has been happening now for a few years is what I've tried to picture on the right-hand side, where there's really sort of two types of solutions in the market. I mean, oversimplifying a lot, obviously. Mm-hmm. But what I would call sort of the classical systems, the Audi A6s, really safe, very solid. They've proven that they have a fantastic track record, fantastic cars. I mean, you can't get it wrong, really. If you buy a car like that, you'll be safe. But you just mentioned the 3-year implementation horizon, and then what? And what could be happening is that you're going to maybe be writing off your Audi A6 diesel a little bit faster than you anticipated, because there's a number of new kids on the block that are really changing the game and maybe gaining momentum because they have something really different to offer. Mm-hmm. And even though they still got four wheels and a steering wheel, etc., but they are changing. And they all have this is an S&OP example, but I think in the other areas you can probably say very similar, make very similar statements that there is something's changing, and that means that there's basically a risk with two sides. One is you could be missing out if you're too conservative. are, but also in the same sentence also, you have to mention that if you jump the gun, one, because maybe the technology wasn't mature enough for you, or maybe because it's also asking different things from your internal organization and the competencies of the people, you might get it wrong as well. So I think from that aspect, something makes it more interesting, gives you more options, but also you have to be a bit more careful with, or a bit more aware than last time, that there are really there's things going on.
Yeah. My observation on this is, you know, twofold. One, you know, it's interesting that you are considering cars as an analogy. Loris Cesaria is also recommending companies to do test drive. You know, don't follow the path of, you know, all these RFPs, RFQs, RFIs, and etc. You know, take a test drive as quick as possible. So, you know, test drive in a sense, a live demo of a customer case similar to your environment. So that's the one thing. So selecting a car, you know, use a test drive. That's one thing. Another thing is, you know, maybe you don't want to have just one car, but you have to replace your whole fleet. Like the previous example that we shown, the whole ecosystem, you don't need just, a lease car like an Audi A6 or what is it? But maybe you have to also have a diesel truck, a forklift truck, maybe some other cars for your PAs, whatever. So maybe you have to have a whole fleet. And the thing is, do you want a whole fleet by Daimler-Benz Mercedes, or do you want to have a cherry picking, combining Peugeot with Mercedes or whatever? What I see, you know, it's just not looking at one car, but basically when you have a supply chain planning ecosystem, you need a whole fleet. So that's the second notion on my side. And what you mentioned, you know, and that's also an interesting notion, what you mentioned earlier, there's something happening, a lot of things are happening under the hood. So can you explain it here?
Yeah, no, that's right. So I think there's basically two trends more or less in parallel. The modern, what they still call classical systems, don't get me wrong on that, they're fantastic systems. And they have made huge steps in the past few years. There's a good reason why the investments in S&P and IBP software have gone up significantly, also at the leading companies in the last years, because the functionality, the link with the process, the way we would like to run them, with things that were almost unthinkable several years ago, in terms of flexibility, scenario planning, aggregation, disaggregation, the way we would really like to have it, they all offer that. So that's one driver that's been going on, where the V6 is a completely different engine, car fully online as it used to be. But then on top of that, we also then now all of a sudden see that when you open the hood, there's nothing there anymore. It's a black box. Because we have some of them are able to exploit AI, machine learning, the pictures that you show with using unstructured data. I mean, if I think about 09, if you want, you can get the they will give you data sets about market development, etc. And the engine will find out whether you can improve your forecast based on that. Now, that's sort of a completely different world that's building on top of the functionality at the top. So I think that's an extremely interesting development, and I'm sure it's going to speed up. And you really move from the highly structured, hard-coded ERP supply chain planning systems, throw the data in data cubes in a BW, in a business warehouse, to build your standard reports, to more generic intelligent engines that find relationships. That's really sort of a different world, more or less evolving or revolutionizing next to the world that I'm trying to describe at the top.
Yeah, no, and that's also totally in line of my visualization of this convergent planning tower, where you have your standing part that maybe is that's the foundation. What would you describe your V6 engine? And on top of that, yeah, that's the roof where you look at your market demand and supply demand and your end to end. Then you have your digital twin in a totally different way with external data, with error technology. You can even talk to error technology and the system will talk back to you. with all the data that it's coming up with and insights. So that's unheard of, that you know your system is talking to you and then giving some reinsurance about some scenarios and some risk at that end. So that's the new world. And you had also some notion about that, talking about these kind of era technologies, and you mentioned already 09 with all the intriguing data sets. So what's your, you know, your comment on this area?
Yeah, what I find is this is more sort of a marketing communication slide than a functionality slide that sort of demonstrates to me that this world is one, they're extremely mature because they're really ahead of the pack. At the same time, you can also sense that it's still sort of immature.
Yeah.
And if I look at the era and also online websites, it feels to me like sort of an old-fashioned German car advertisement where. If you look at the modern parts, it's all about lifestyle and about functionality and about what it can do for you. And if you look at the era and the O9 websites, it's all about their engines and how fantastic they can use with. So how they work, not why you should do
no.
that.
Yeah,
and that I think that's sort of a fairly clear sign that this is development's not over yet. I mean, they really need to explain what they do, not why they do it.
I totally agree. I think you know they have to differentiate themselves from the rest, that their approach is different, but also you know that they you know are coming from a different angle with a different approach, and I totally agree. But the one thing I know, and I've been working with these kind of companies and webinars and other marketing communication project we did last year, you know, there's a lot to explain, and also from all the parties, even ERA and 09, and maybe they have to prove them more and more what they have done with customers and what differentiates from the rest.
Yeah, and that's it. And that also builds that means that if you're company X or Y, you work in a certain segment, the assessment whether it is useful and worthwhile to consider these guys is not always so trivial because is functionality, can I really exploit it? What's the impact on my organization? Can my people handle it? Do we have the data, etc.? That's all questions that didn't, well, they existed in the past also, but now that pops up at a different sort of order of magnitude.
Yes, and if you look at my IT vendor map, the four blocks, the four matrices with the functionality, technology, delivery, and knowledge, I think, you know, they tend to only focus on functionality and technology and not so much delivery. What have they already done? And what do they know from the market? And what kind of knowledge have they gained from applying their technology in certain areas? All right, almost wrapping up. I see some questions. I will get to the Q&A after this. But you have some ideas on how to approach it consequently.
Yeah, so I think this is, let's not go into all the individual circles, but I think what this tries to demonstrate is that when we try and make a perfect match between a vendor, a company that is looking for new or updated tooling and the tools themselves, then the number of aspects to consider always was relatively, was significant. But I think what I said for earlier, it used to always start with the functionality, technology, and then let's do the RFI and make sure that we all understand what the system can do. And some of these aspects still are there. Right? They're all still there. But on top of that, we get more aspects now to consider, which makes it more interesting and also a bit more challenging about where to go. And I think my sort of my own hobby horse sits on the left bottom corner, what I would call the DNA of the software. Mm-hmm. This, I think, is it's never on paper, but somehow I tend to consider that to a very significant extent.
Yep.
Is what's their background? What are their references? If I'm looking at a particular industry, is there a match? Because, and you're not going to find it from the functionality because they can all do it. I think that part is maybe sometimes underestimated in terms of are they the perfect match for you or not.
Yeah, we did get an overview and I did some studies what the DNA is. You know, SAP is very strong in financial. That's their background. So there are different areas and I've, you know, been through the whole S&OP cycle and where they have the strongest point. To wrap up, you know, you see here the logo in the middle. I didn't know what it was, but you explained that's the logo of Tinder, isn't it?
Yeah, I found it on Google. I think it's a nice overview. It's not only the looks, the look and feel, which is on the right hand side, but there's a bit more to it if you want to make the perfect match.
Yeah, you know, we on the hour, and you know, the good point is we have still 30 minutes left after this in the lounge. So we I'm supposed to wrap up. I see some questions, but they are, you know, maybe better to discuss with me personally. You know, what's your take on the acquisition of BlueJay Solutions by E2 Open last month? I can't comment on that. So let's leave the Q&A for the next 30 minutes in the lounge. I see here, you know, there are some links to the IT Submit map, and to the right-hand side, you know, you see the contact details of Hans and also the SNLP IBP magazine they have created together with us. So that would be interesting to watch and to read. And for now, I'd like to thank you for joining us at this webinar and to watch this. You know, maybe I see you next in a lounge if you have questions to talk further about what we have been discussing in this webinar. If not, maybe I see you next week. We're going to talk about supply chain resilience. For now, Hans, thank you for joining me.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity, Martijn. Well appreciated.
Thanks a lot. And I'm going to wrap up. So thank you for now. And I will stop this session right now. And we'll take a break. And we go right after this into the lounge. So if you discuss things further with Hans and me, just go to the lounge. And then we'll see you there. Thanks a lot. And maybe I see you next time. Bye-bye.